everyone. Welcome to today's Pet Pawcast. I'm your host, Dr. Roberta Westbrook, and I'm so glad that you're joining us today here at the Campus for All Animals, the Houston SPCA. I encourage all of you to come on down this weekend, bring your family and friends, and come spend some time with the animals that we have available for adoption. We have dogs and cats and puppies and kittens and rabbits and guinea pigs, and we're sure that you can find a pet that will fit your family and you can provide a forever home to a loving pet. I do want to introduce you to one of the wonderful dogs that we have available for adoption right now, and his name is Reginald. Reginald is about a two-year-old neutered male Australian cattle dog mix. Reginald has a lot of activity. He is very excited to play with kids and people and toys. He has a lot of energy. So if you're an active family, if you like to go running or go on hikes, or you have a job that Reginald can help you do, Reginald would be the perfect dog for you because he's very, very smart and he loves to interact with people and to please you. So please come on down and visit with him. He's a really wonderful dog, as you can see. Loves to play with people, lots of energy. So we have Reginald and we have lots of other dogs that we feel like would be great pets and family members for you guys. So today we're talking about how to keep your pets safe during the summer. And one of those things is, if you're living in Texas or particularly anywhere in the South, you know that the heat brings bugs, all kinds of bugs, big ones, small ones, dangerous ones, not so dangerous ones. And we want to talk to you about what dangers to be aware of when it comes to those summer bugs and your pets, and how you can keep them safe. So get your questions ready, and let's get into all those tiny little bugs that are gonna be a big part of our lives this summer. So one that's very common that all of you guys have probably experienced is fleas. So fleas are super common, you know, particularly in the hot months, the flea population goes up, and it's not uncommon for you to realize that your pet has fleas. And how might you notice this? You might first notice that your pet has an increase in itching and scratching. So scratching at their head or their neck, or doing what we call corn cob chewing. If you notice that your pet is doing this on their limbs or on their body, and they're doing this, it looks like they're chewing on a corn cob, that could be indicative of a flea infestation, because they're chasing that flea throughout the fur and they're trying to get it and eat it. And we want to make sure that your pets stay free of fleas. So if you want to keep your pet free of fleas, please talk to your family veterinarian about what flea prevention may be best for your pet. There's lots of them. There's some that your pet can take orally, like a tablet. There are some that are liquid that can be placed on your pet's skin, usually between the shoulder blades on the back. Some can be given as safely as every day, and some can be given once a month. And so this is something that you can talk to your family veterinarian about with fleas. Now, fleas are not the only bug that your pet can encounter. And fleas, as a matter of fact, can also transmit some diseases. So we want to make sure that you get those fleas taken care of. One of the most common things that fleas will transmit are tapeworms. So tapeworms are an intestinal parasite that your pet can get if they ingest a flea. And you might notice tapeworms in your pet's poop, because they look like small white grains of rice that are moving around. They're usually small, they're white, they're somewhat flat, and they're moving around in the stool. Sometimes they're very small, and then sometimes they link together like a chain. And so it can look like a chain of white little grains of rice in your dog's stool. If you see that, please contact your family veterinarian. They can get you treated right away. So next up, ticks. Ticks are another common summer bug that you are going to see, particularly if you like to go hiking or you're around wooded, grassy areas where your pets are spending time. You might notice that your pet has ticks. Now, how might you notice this? Oftentimes, you either see those ticks or you might feel them. So as you're petting your dog and you're running your fingers through their hair coat, you could run into like a little bump or a lump in the fur, the skin. Sometimes that can be a tick. Now, ticks can be very small and flat, but as they begin to feed on your pet's blood, as they kind of embed themselves in your pet's skin and take a blood meal, those ticks become big and engorged with blood, and they become much more visible to the eye. You might find ticks in the ears, so on the inside of your pet's ears. You can find them between your pet's toes and on the underside of their toes, and oftentimes in little skin creases like in the armpits or the groin area. These are places that ticks love to hide. So that might be a place that you can look to find ticks. If you find ticks, again, this is something that you want to contact your veterinarian about so they can get you proper tick prevention so that you don't have to worry about any of the diseases that ticks can spread. So what questions do you have so far?
So what is the proper way to remove a tick if we find one?
That's a great question. So if you find a tick on your pet, you really do want to remove it if you're comfortable. You want to remove it as soon as possible. The reason is it can take several hours for those ticks to transmit certain diseases. So if you can get the ticks off sooner rather than later, you may be able to prevent those diseases from being spread. So talk to your veterinarian about doing this if you don't feel comfortable. But typically, if you're at home and you want to remove a tick, the first thing you want to do is identify where that tick is. And depending on your pet, you may need a second person to help hold your pet still while you try to remove the tick. Now, at veterinary clinics, most of us have instruments that we call hemostats that we use to remove ticks. But at home, you may have a pair of tweezers that you can use. And what you want to do is part your animal's fur so that you can get a really good visualization of that tick that's embedded in the skin. And you want to take your hemostat or your tweezers, and you want to get as close to the skin as possible without pinching your pet's skin. So you want to kind of grab onto the body of the tick, or excuse me, the head of the tick that's implanted into the skin, as close to the skin as possible. And then you want to pull gently upward with a little bit of upward pressure straight out. You don't want to twist or pull that tick, because what you don't want to do is break off parts of the body of the tick and leave them embedded in your pet's skin. You want to make sure you have a nice smooth movement straight up and out of your pet skin so that you get all of the body and the head out at the same time. And then you may want to clean that area with some alcohol or maybe some antibiotic ointment. But this might be a good thing that you contact your family veterinarian about first. They can help you. And if you go into the clinic, oftentimes the veterinarian or the technicians there can show you how to do this properly so that you can do it for yourself in the future.
And then how do we kill the tick so make sure he doesn't latch on to another pet?
Yeah, so you always want to make sure that you can put the tick in some alcohol or, you know, completely, you know, submerge the tick in the trash so that it does not able to get out and get to any of your other pets or other pets out in the environment. But if you put that tick in a little bit of alcohol, usually that's enough to kill them.
And a myth that someone poses, is it true that burning a tick can cause it to release, or does that cause more damage?
Oh, well, you certainly do not ever want to use any fire near your pet's skin. This can be very, very dangerous. Certainly, it could kill the tick, but it's going to do some damage to your pet, too. So I would say don't use a lighter or a match or anything on ticks near your pet's skin. You don't want their fur to catch on fire. You don't want to cause burns to your pet's skin. So that would be a way that I would avoid if you're trying to get rid of ticks. It's much safer just to pull them straight out, put them into some alcohol.
And if a dog has a tick, does that mean they automatically have Lyme disease?
So, you know, I did mention the reason that you want to remove ticks as soon as possible is because ticks can transmit some diseases. And in general, we call them tick-borne diseases, and there's several of them. There's Lyme disease, there's Rocky Mountain spotted fever, and ehrlichiosis and babesiosis, and lots of tick-borne diseases that can have some pretty significant effects in your pet. And now, just because your pet has a tick does not mean that they automatically have one of these diseases. You may notice that after you find a tick or ticks on your pet, that within a few weeks, sometimes you'll notice that your pet begins to feel ill. And signs of tick-borne diseases tend to be lethargy. They can have vomiting, diarrhea. Sometimes they have unexplained limping or joint swelling. And in some severe cases, they can have bleeding tendencies. And so you want to take your pet into the family veterinarian right away. If you notice any of those signs at all, it could be indications that they've contracted a tick-borne disease. But oftentimes tick-borne diseases are treatable and have a fair to good prognosis depending on when you find them.
And you mentioned prevention before. We can see there's a few options on there. Are there any of those that are store-bought, or are those needing prescriptions?
Yes, behind me I have lots of options for flea and tick preventions. And I would recommend talking to your veterinarian about the proper product for you. We all want to find products that are inexpensive and that are convenient to get. And so we're tempted to go to the grocery store or the pet store and get a common flea or tick prevention. And I will say, oftentimes these products may not be harmful, but sometimes your pet, particularly sensitive pets like cats, can have difficulty processing and metabolizing some of the drugs in these medications that you get over the counter. Prescription medications overall tend to be a little bit safer and have fewer side effects. So if, particularly if you're looking for flea and or tick prevention for your cat, I would avoid anything over the counter and I would see your family veterinarian. But lots of these products are you can get from your family veterinarian, some like Brevecto and NexGard. You can get these either topically or as an oral chewable tablet. There are sprays that you can safely spray on your pet's hair coat. There are some like Capstar that are safe enough to give every single day for fleas. And so we have lots of, and then there's some topicals here. So there are plenty of options. But I would say the best thing to do is figure out, one, which type of product you want. Do you want an oral tablet or do you want something topical? And then talk to your veterinarian about which might be safest for your pet. You can oftentimes find combination products too, ones that prevent fleas, ticks, heartworm disease, and intestinal parasites. And so it might be a little bit less expensive and more convenient for you to do an all-in-one.
So if someone has like just the flea collar, do you also recommend something else? Is it because of there's different stages of a flea life that attack?
Sure. So flea collars are a common thing as well. And you, again, it's kind of depending on what you feel like is most appropriate for your pet. So flea collars can last several weeks to months, depending on the type that you have. They have chemicals in them that release the chemical slowly, and it kind of absorbs through your pet's hair coat over time. And so this could be something that's beneficial to you. It may not be beneficial if you're trying to cover lots of different bugs at the same time. So you may want to decide with your family veterinarian what's in the best interest of your pet. Particularly if you're going outside a lot, you're in wooded areas and spending a lot of time outdoors, you may need something that is a little bit more effective than the average flea collar.
And would you recommend a specific shampoo for fleas or like Dawn soap?
Sure. So there's lots of things that you can put on your pet to try to rid the coat of fleas. So over-the-counter flea shampoos overall tend to be fairly safe. Again, you may want to contact your family veterinarian and see if they have something that they recommend specifically for your pet. But you can get lots of safe flea shampoos over the counter. For example, Adam's flea and tick shampoo is a very common one. Dawn dish soap, if you have that, lots of us just have that in our house. Dawn dish soap is pretty effective and safe at removing fleas, particularly from really young or small animals. It's something safe and it's chemical free. So that might be one option that you can try for trying to remove fleas. And then don't forget that you can try to remove these fleas just by getting a flea comb and going through your pet's coat really thoroughly. It has very fine teeth and it'll help you to identify, find those fleas in the pet's coat and remove them pretty easily.
So with summer, we know come more mosquitoes. Is there a repellent that I should get for my pets?
Yeah, so we're talking about summer bugs, fleas, ticks, but a really big one, probably the biggest one that can cause the most life-threatening disease is the mosquito. So mosquitoes, we've got them. We even got them year-round here in Texas. And mosquitoes we're most concerned about because they transmit heartworm disease to our dogs and our cats. So heartworm disease is caused by a tiny little parasite that we call Dirofilaria immitis. And that is a little blood parasite that travels throughout your pet's bloodstream once it has been deposited there by a mosquito. And eventually, as it matures in your pet's body, it lives in the heart. And that parasite, that worm, lives in the heart. And it can cause heart failure and even death if going untreated. So if you're trying to prevent heartworm disease and you're trying to prevent mosquitoes from biting your pet, there are some prescription products that are able to repel mosquitoes and prevent them from biting your pet. Please see your family veterinarian about those prescription products. One thing you do not want to do, though, is use the mosquito repellent that we would use. A lot of the mosquito repellents that we use and people have a chemical in them called a DEET, and that DEET, and that can be toxic to our pets. So you want to be very careful about using mosquito repellents that you would use on your body. But there are some prescription medications that you can use. And there's also heartworm prevention, such that even if your pet gets bitten by a mosquito, they have medication that can help prevent the mosquito from transmitting that potentially life-threatening parasite.
So someone's wondering, they have an indoor pet who stays inside all the time. Why would they need prevention as well for mosquitoes?
Yes, you might think, you know, I have an indoor cat, or my dog only goes outside to use the restroom. Why do I need to have a monthly flea or tick prevention or heartworm prevention? And mosquitoes get inside. So as you know, if you've ever been sitting in your house and you've gotten a mosquito bite in your house, that's because mosquitoes get in. When you have the door open to carry groceries in from the car, or just coming in and out from work or the gym, wherever you're going, mosquitoes will make their way inside your house. And that means you're at risk for mosquito bites. It also means your dog, your cat, your pets are at risk for mosquito bites. You can also bring in fleas and ticks on your clothing. So if you have a lot of bushes, shrubbery, tall grass, woods around your house, sometimes just walking through those areas, fleas and ticks may attach themselves to your clothing or your shoes, and you can bring those things inside your house. So please make sure you're keeping your pet safe, even if they spend most of their time indoors.
So if someone's enjoying their time outside in the backyard and their dog accidentally steps on an ant pile, what can they do to help relieve that? Or is there anything they need to watch out for?
Yes, ouch, stepping in ant piles. You know, ants are very fast and they can certainly cause lots of bites in a short period of time. So if you notice that your pet is, you know, seeming painful on their paws or biting at their paws, please try to get those ants off of them as soon as possible. You can use that just with your hand, or even with a water hose, kind of giving them a bath to get that off of them. But also their paws, or wherever they have sustained ant bites, it could become really inflamed and red. You want to kind of cool down that itching. You can do that with cool water or cool towel on those paws. You may also contact your veterinarian. If your veterinarian has seen your pet, they may also give you a direction to administer an over-the-counter antihistamine, such as Benadryl. That can help with the allergic reaction, but you do have to contact your veterinarian for this, because it is based on your pet's size and type, and so you don't just want to prescribe or give your pet a medication without contacting your veterinarian first. But certainly there are some things that you can get to keep your pet more comfortable.
So in Houston, I know we see those little furry caterpillars called asps. Are those dangerous to dogs as well?
Sure, those can be dangerous too. So when we have these little caterpillars, they can be very painful when they sting your pet. And sometimes the little fur can get caught in your pet's skin. So this is another thing to be aware of. If you see those, maybe clear. You can talk to actually a local pest control company and talk to them about the type of, you know, bugs, summer bugs that you're trying to rid your environment of to keep your pet safe. And they may be able to spray your yard with something that's appropriate to get rid of things like the fleas and the ticks and caterpillars and things like that, and give you options for, you know, safe products for your pets as well.
So something else we find in our backyard are toads in the summer. So, and our dogs love to try to mess with them and play with them. If they accidentally lick one or bite one, is that dangerous to them?
Yes, sometimes, you know, if you have a dog that really is interested in some of these toads that you find in your backyard, you might notice that as they bite at the toads, or if they try to ingest one, that they may have signs related to irritation in the mouth. So drooling a lot, maybe vomiting or shaking their head. And that's oftentimes because they have secreted a toxin that can be really irritating to the dogs. And so it might be a good idea to, again, if you're noticing that you have toads, keep your dog away from them. Encourage them not to try to bite at or ingest those toads. But if you notice that that's occurring, contact your family veterinarian about ways that you can make your pet feel more comfortable after that interaction.
And earlier you mentioned, you know, cats having prevention too for heartworms. So that means they can get heartworms as well?
Oh, absolutely. Cats can get heartworms as well. We don't talk about heartworms as often in cats, but we should, because they absolutely are susceptible and can get heartworm disease. And oftentimes in cats, they don't have the same long-term symptoms that dogs do. The unfortunate thing about cats and heartworm disease is that when they get heartworm disease, it tends to be fatal quicker than it is in dogs. And so it's definitely important to keep your cat on heartworm prevention year-round, particularly if you're in the southern states where mosquitoes are at a high level.
Somebody has a new puppy. What is the age that it's safe for them to start on the prevention?
Yeah, so when you're talking about flea, tick, and heartworm prevention, most products are labeled to be used as soon as 8 weeks old. So I would say about 8 weeks, but it does depend on the product. Some products are not labeled for use until your pet is 12 weeks old, but your veterinarian will make sure that they are prescribing you the right product for your pet based on their age.
So when summer is finally over and it starts cooling down, can we stop worrying about mosquitoes and ticks?
Oh gosh, I wish we could, but here in Texas and all the southern states, we wish we could say that we don't have to worry about some of these summer bugs when it becomes fall and winter. But really, we have mosquito populations year-round. The weather stays relatively warm here, and so we deal with fleas and ticks and mosquitoes year-round. So I would say make sure that you continue to give your pet those products year-round so that you don't wind up with a serious, potentially life-threatening infection. Well, I know we've gone through a lot here. I appreciate you guys joining us for the short time every Friday at the Pet Pawcast and looking at the wonderful pets like Reginald that we have available for adoption. They are here waiting for you. We're excited to have you come on our campus and take a look at the pets and consider taking a new pet into your home this summer. So please, if you're interested in joining our family, you can support us by going to www.houstonspca.org, and you can become a volunteer, you can become a foster, and you can look for options for employment with us. So there's lots of ways that you can join our family, and we're happy to have you. Thank you for joining us every week, and we will see you next week on the Pet Pawcast.